Hey everybody, I'm Nathaniel Dodson from tutvid.com. Welcome right into this Premiere Pro tutorial where we're going to take a look at creating this parallel sky rotation transition effect. You know what? Just check it out. That might be the easiest way to describe what this is. Pretty cool, right? I thought it was pretty neat. We're going to cover exactly how to do everything that you just saw, as well as kind of a neat little trick when it comes to exporting this video, or really it has to do with the setup of the video. Well, you know what? You'll see if you stick around and check it out. Now, if you do enjoy the video, we'll make sure that you you subscribe to my YouTube channel so you never miss any Premiere Pro, After Effects, video editing, even some DaVinci Resolve we're doing these days. Any video editing tutorials, you won't miss any of them if you are subscribed to the channel, so make sure you do that. And with that out of the way, let's jump into Premiere right now and check this thing out. Ah, well, here I am in Premiere Pro, and the first thing I'll do is create a new sequence from this video clip by right-clicking on the clip and choosing to create a new sequence. Then I'm going to find the sequence in the project bin and just change the name of it to something like Flipped Effect, just so it's not the full long video file's name. And then I'm going to drag in my soundtrack beneath this. I got my soundtrack from Epidemic Sound. They aren't sponsoring this video, but number one, they should be. And number two, they still have a pretty killer setup over there. Lots of great stuff. I love them quite a bit. To get the best outcome with this effect, you really want to use a video that has the top edge that's one continuous edge of something. It can be a solid color, it can be the sky, it could be water, really any kind of solid color or texture that will blend or mesh well. And it's also best to have the foreground content of the video somewhat close to that top edge. In my case, with this video, that means I'll actually be better served to have the RV driving a little closer to the top of the frame of this shot. To do this, I'll select the clip on my timeline, then look to the Effect Controls panel, and I'll boost the scale of the clip to like 120%. Now, this will be a little detrimental to our quality, and we'll be talking a little bit about quality later, so we just have to know that we're going to take the good with the bad here. But after I upscale this to 120%. I'll then adjust the positioning for the y-axis until there's less sky in the shot. Just bump it up a little bit, maybe move it over. I can double-click on my monitor and just manually move it with the mouse as well. Once I've got a shot with less sky, I'll right-click on the clip in the timeline and choose Nest to create a nested sequence, and I'm going to name this something stupid. I'll just name it Nesty. Next, go to the Effects panel down here and search for the Replicate effect. Then drop that on the video clip that we just were working on, well, really the nested sequence, and then set the replicate to 3 in the Effect Controls panel. Now we're going to go and find an effect called Mirror in the Effects panel. Drag that, drop it on the clip. And here I'm going to set the mirror effect to 1279 on the X and 540 on the Y, and I'm going to give it a reflection angle of 0 degrees. Then I'm going to right-click on this mirror effect and choose to copy it, and then right-click in the Effect Controls panel and choose to paste the effect. I'm going to change the reflection angle here to 180 degrees, then I'm going to change the X input to 640, and I'll leave the Y value at 540. That's fine. Now I'll copy and paste this mirror effect again, and this time I'm going to set the reflection angle to 90 degrees, and here I will leave the X value at 640, and this time I'm going to change the Y value to 719. Next, I'm going to copy and paste the mirror effect one last time, and here I'll set the reflection angle to 270 degrees. I'll change the Y value to 360 and leave the X value at 640, just like I did with the last copy and paste. Now, a quick pro tip, this is kind of a base effect where we create this three across, three up and down, fully reflected video effect, and I use it in a number of preset transitions and things like that that I like to do, so it's a good idea to save this whole thing as a preset. So you can just hold down your Command or Control key, select those 5 different effects in your Effect Controls panel, right-click, choose to save them as a preset, and for something like this, I would probably name it 3x3, just as a 3x3 across. We know exactly what it's going to do when we add it to any clip or adjustment layer. All right, so now with that out of the way, we're going to search for the transform effect and drag that over and drop it on our video clip. And the first thing I'm going to do is set the scale in transform here to 300% to zoom us back into the center area of this 3x3 clip effect and kind of make the video look, you know, normal again. Now that that's done, let's build the effect by bumping in 6 or so frames into where the first audio drop is beginning to hit. Right here at the beginning of this, I'm going to drop a keyframe for the position parameter of the transform effect, and then I'll move to the end of that first peak of sound in my main timeline, and I'll adjust the Y parameter here of the position. I'm going to adjust the Y to 700 to push the footage downward a little bit. Now, we want to blend the sky coming down from the top just to make it just mesh together, blend together, whatever, a little bit better. So I'm also going to add an animation to the mirror effect that's controlling the row of video that is kind of dealing with the stuff above our center video. So I can use the little FX icons and effect controls to turn on and off effects until I find the one that it is. I happen to know it's the one here that's right above transform. So I'll select that. And in this effect, I'll drop a keyframe for the reflection center parameter right where the other animation for our position began by aligning those keyframes and then move to where the second keyframe is for the position parameter in the transform effect. You can use the little next previous keyframe buttons, by the way. And here above the second keyframe, I'm going to change the reflection center to 445 on the Y axis. Now, go ahead and hit the little rectangle icon to drop a rectangular mask. I'm going to drag the mask over to the center left position, and then drag a selection over the anchor points on the right side of the mask, and hold shift, and drag these all the way over to the other side of the frame, in fact, a little past the other side of the frame. Now, once I have my mask in place, I'll set the feather of the mask to 110, and maybe even bump the mask expansion to like 25 or something right around there. Now, nothing on the mask gets animated. The mask is just going to kind of hang out there and do its thing. All the animation is happening in the mirror effect itself. So now let's do the cool turning and flipping rotations to make this effect really work. Move the playhead to an area of the timeline a few frames before you see another audio drop. So I'll move it over right here. And I'll add a keyframe for the rotation parameter by hitting the stopwatch icon there next to the word rotation. And then I'll move to the right where the first part of the drop is peaking. And I'll change the rotation to negative 60 degrees. Then I'm going to move the playhead to just before the second part of this audio bump here. Right before it starts, I'm going to add another keyframe that's going to hold the negative 60 rotation. I'm going to do that by clicking on the little diamond icon. That's sort of the new keyframe button. Then I'll move to the peak of that second audio bump, and I'll just hit that little reset rotation parameter, the little flip-a-rooski arrow right there. And then I'll select all four of these keyframes, I'll right-click, and just choose Auto Bezier to add just some nice swing and bump easing to this animation that we just created. It really helps kind of top the effect off a little bit. Now, I'll also uncheck the Use Composition Shutter Angle option here in the Transform effect, and I'll also specify right below that a 360-degree shutter angle. You may need to scroll down if you don't see it right away, but trust me, it's in there. This is just going to give us some nice motion blur to go with our animation. Now I can move down to the next bump in audio and add another animation, and maybe this time I'll animate the rotation going the other direction. So I'll just go straight 135 degree angle, and I'll use the technique that we just used. After that, I'll add one last animation that flips this thing directly to 90 degrees and then back. So we'll have two additional animations here, and then we'll be ready to render out our video clip. So speaking of rendering this thing out, because of how we created this effect, we've really hurt the quality of the video, and it'll render out something like 360p quality, even if we have our settings set to a 1080p export, just because of that whole 3x thing we did, and then we boosted the size to 300% to compensate. But remember, even the original video clip we had boosted to 120% to get the framing and composition that we wanted. So it's not perfect. But the best and fastest workaround I found for getting a much higher quality export, depending on the footage you have and everything, but what I found works the best in almost all situations, is to do exactly this. That would be create a new sequence by again right-clicking the video clip as we did at the beginning of this tutorial and creating a sequence from it, and then going sequence settings, and make sure you're still working with 2997 frames there near the top, and then we're going to set the size to the rather massive 5760 by 3240 resolution. So this is just three times the size of our original image. Now, we can right-click on the clip in the timeline. It's that small, sitting in the middle there of the composition now. Now, we can right-click the video clip on the timeline. You can see it sitting there. It looks kind of small in the middle of our sequence now, doesn't it? And we'll right-click on that video clip in the timeline and choose to scale it to the frame size. Then we'll jump back over to the finished effect that we have in just our standard 1080p sequence. We can select all the effects that we have in the control panel there, the replicate, the mirrors, and the transform, by just holding down Command or Control and clicking them all, and then right-click and choose to copy them. Now head back over to the new massive sequence and select the video clip on the timeline and paste these effects into the effect controls panel. Now, side note, very, very important here. Make sure you drag the transform effect to the bottom of the stack and drag the replicate effect back to the top of the stack. Now, if you have a slow computer or even a moderately fast computer, things are going to slow way down here because this is a massive file at this point. But what you can do is export this huge file and downsize it. We can downsize it at this point to a standard 4K size, and we can get from that a passable 1080p file. I found that the best settings for me come when I'm exporting using the 4K preset within the H.264 selection in the export panel, and I push the bitrate MBPS, the megabits per second, I push that up to 50, and I'll use the variable bitrate, that's the VBR, I'll just do one pass. That seems to be pretty good. It's much, much better than just exporting straight up at 1080p. For some reason, the quality is just horrendous at that size. So if you export the 4K, you can get a decent quality video, and then you just, you know, if you're playing it in QuickTime, you zoom back a little bit, and it actually looks pretty decent. Obviously, in my case, because I bumped it that initial 120% way back at the beginning, we're just going to have some limitations in terms of quality because we're upsizing the video, and it's really not meant to be upsized like that. So I just have to keep that in the back of my mind. But you can play with different settings and different sizes and see what works for you and just find out a good way to get a nice, high-quality version of this really cool effect. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we have created this effect. I am pumped. I'm fired up. I'm excited for it. Now, if you did enjoy it, remember, subscribe to my channel so you never miss any tutorials in the future. And also, we just started a Discord chat. We're trying to build a little community over there. It's a little happening place. We're doing what we can to make it that. Make sure you use the link down there in the bio to jump over onto our Discord server or chat room. I don't know. I'm new to Discord. I'm new to this whole thing. So I don't even have the proper terminology down. So come over and school me. But hopefully by the time you see this video, we'll have a little bit of a community going on over there, and you are more than welcome to come and join and share what you've done, share what you got, show your stuff, ask questions, have a little bit of fun with the rest of us. That's what it's all about. So for creating this effect in Premiere Pro and working with Transform and Easing and just everything else that went into making this happen, guys, that's it. Get it? Got it? Good. Nathaniel Dodson, tutvid.com. I'll catch you in the next one. And before you go, make sure you subscribe to my channel for more great tutorials every day. Also, buy my course. It helps us do what we do, and this channel is supported by viewers just like you. You can also just click the thumbnail and watch another video from this channel. See you next time, guys.